Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Bill Taylor. I'm the Executive Vice President here at the United States Institute of Peace. And we are very pleased to welcome you here on Monday morning for this discussion of three reports. And you'll hear more about each of those in a moment. Institute of Peace was founded in 1984 by Congress as an independent national institute. Dedicated to the proposition that peace is possible, that it's practical, and that it's essential for national security and international security. We provide people and organizations and individuals abroad with the tools to seek peace, seek ways to avoid violent conflict. And indeed, we're talking about violent conflict here this morning, discussing violent extremism, a global threat dating back millennia. Jihadi groups are only among the latest movements to fuel conflicts and use terror tactics. Despite the lessons of 9/11, we failed to predict the emergence of Al-Qaeda in new forms across the Middle East and North Africa. We were blindsided by ISIS's sweep across Syria and Iraq, which at least temporarily changed the map of the Middle East. Both movements have continued to evolve and surprise, while producing dozens of franchises across the globe. And we'll hear more about these franchises here today. In 2015, ISIS-affiliated groups engaged in attacks across 28 countries, more than double the number in 2014. Last year, deaths from terrorism rose by 650% in the 35 countries that belong to the OECD. This rise in extremism coincides with growing political instability. As other three reports released today illustrate, these two trends feed off each other. U.S.-backed allies in Iraq and Syria have recently made progress in confronting the Islamic State, Daesh. By all accounts, ISIS has now lost more than 40% of its caliphate. But just yesterday, Daesh apparently retook Palmyra over the weekend, and so it would be a mistake to assume this progress opens the door to disengagement in the region. Extremism grows from social and political grievances, and the tools provided by military force or good police work cannot alone dry up the emotional and social wellsprings of radicalization. Limited resources, competing political interests, poor coordination further muddy the waters and present a daunting task for the next administration. The U.S. Institute of Peace is committed to helping develop fresh approaches to these challenges. We work on supporting communities to reduce the appeal of violent extremism in Afghanistan, Pakistan, Nigeria, Kenya, North Africa by providing training and expertise, as I mentioned. USIP is also providing policy-shaping research through the Resolve Network, an international consortium of research organizations committed to understanding the local drivers of violent extremism. Our forum today is an extension of this work. Today's panelists will explore future trends in extremism, innovative policy responses, and reflect the analysis from three new reports. The first report, titled The Jihadi Threat, ISIS, Al-Qaeda, and Beyond, was produced by USIP and the Wilson Center. The report is the product of a four-month study led by Robin Wright, whom you will hear momentarily. USIP convened 20 experts from think tanks and universities across the United States to explore the world's deadliest movements, their evolving strategies, future scenarios, and policy considerations. It's the latest collaboration between USIP and the Wilson Center, which also produced the groundbreaking book and website projects such as The Islamists and the Iran Primer. The second report we'll examine today is Turning Point by the Center for Strategic and International Studies Commission on Countering Violent Extremism. The commission was co-chaired by Leon Panetta and Tony Blair. Stephen Hadley, chairman of the USIP board, and USIP president Nancy Lindborg were also commissioners for the project, which calls for a new paradigm using both soft and hard power to forge partnerships from government, civil society, and the private sector to confront extremist ideologies. USIP and CSIS have worked together for several years on foreign policy issues critical to U.S. interests, including partnership on the Iraq Study Group at a critical turning point in the U.S. intervention in Iraq. The third report by the Prevention Project is Communities First, a blueprint for organizing and sustaining a global movement against violent extremism. It identifies the challenges of coordinating a global response to extremism. It offers practical guidance on durable solutions. Robin Wright will moderate the first panel. Robin is a joint fellow at USIP and the Woodrow Wilson Center, and is also an award-winning author, contributing writer for The New Yorker. She brings decades of experience and unique insights to USIP after reporting from 140 countries for The Washington Post and other major news outlets. Please welcome Robin Wright and the first panel.
Good morning, everybody. I'm delighted to have you join us. This is the report that we authored. This is a group of, as Bill said, 20 experts from across the United States who are really into the nitty-gritty of the extremist movements, particularly ISIS, Al-Qaeda, and their franchises. I'm honored, in fact, to be among four of the most distinguished scholars in the country on this issue. To my right, Will McCants, who's a senior fellow at the Brookings Institution and author of The ISIS Apocalypse, The History, Strategy, and Doomsday Vision of the Islamic State. David Gartenstein-Ross is a senior fellow at the Foundation for the Defense of Democracies. He is also a fellow at the International Center for Counterterrorism at The Hague. Fred Wary is a senior fellow at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace and a widely published author. I am in awe of Fred because he has been to Libya twice this year, right in the heart of the conflict. And Hassan Hassan is a senior fellow at the Tahrir Institute for Middle East Policy. Hassan I've been following for ages, a former correspondent himself, and he's a co-author of the New York Times bestseller, ISIS, Inside the Army of Terror. So, as we've painfully witnessed, extremism has evolved traumatically and dramatically since 9/11. Movements, leaders, tactics, strategies, and theaters of operation have all proliferated in ways that were unimagined in 2001. The world has mobilized unprecedented force. The United States alone has spent trillions of dollars in homeland security, diplomacy, the military, to try to counter jihadi extremism. And there has been progress. Between 2001 and 2016, there have only been less than 100 deaths inside the United States from jihadi extremists. And yet, as we all know, the threat endures. And one of the things I thought I'd start with this morning is to give you a brief little look at the different waves of extremism and jihadis, the things we discovered that we thought were actually quite interesting in following the patterns that have evolved in the three major waves of jihadism. The first trend, and there are five of them, is that in sheer numbers, the mobilization of foreign fighters has been larger with each wave than its predecessor. The growth is today exponential, with surviving jihadis and fighters of previous generations becoming very important catalysts for the next, for the new generation. The pattern suggests that the next jihadi conflict will have ever greater numbers than the last, and that recruitment is likely to surge in large part because the best recruiters of the new jihadis are the ones who participated in the last one. The second trend is that each mobilization of fighters has been faster than the last. The time required for jihadis to act or swarm, in the language of jihadism, in each theater of conflict is roughly half of what it took the previous wave. The ease of global travel and social media are obviously key components. They've solved the problems of coordination and expedited the travel and mobilization. The third trend is that the foreign fighter pool has diversified with each wave. The first generation of jihadis galvanized during the Afghan war was predominantly from the Arabian Peninsula, often known as the Afghan Arabs. Gulf fighters have consistently contributed the largest contingency among foreign fighters, but the proportion, because each group has been larger, the proportion of fighters from the Gulf has decreased with each wave. During the second wave in Iraq between 2003 and 2011, North Africans showed a dramatic increase against the US-led coalition. North Africans constituted about one quarter of all foreign fighters during that second wave. During the third wave between 2012 and 2015, Central Asians and particularly Europeans mobilized in unprecedented numbers to join the ranks of the Islamic State, a troubling development particularly for Western countries. The fourth trend is that each generation has become more extreme. The trend is not specific to just jihadi groups. We saw the same pattern emerge in Algeria, as well as among Palestinian groups between the 1970s and 1990s, when groups splintered and younger fighters grew ever more impatient with the older generation and sought to execute more brazen attacks than their forefathers. ISIS and Al-Qaeda have followed similar patterns, with younger fighters becoming ever more aggressive. The fifth trend is that in the future, jihadis are likely to spread out to more locations and similar causes, and for reasons that might not be as obvious. First and foremost, jihadism has become a profession, not just a set of beliefs or a belief system. And once mobilized, it's often very difficult to demobilize foreign fighters, that whole wave. And foreign fighters who do demobilize are likely to remain an important part of the overall fabric of jihadism or modern jihads, becoming facilitators and becoming supporters, pushing the agenda even if they don't join the latest jihad themselves. So we're going to run our panel as Q&A. I'm going to do a couple of rounds and then open it up to all of you. And I'm going to start with Will McCants. So we've seen ISIS take incredible losses, 57% of the territory in Iraq, almost 30% of the territory now in Syria, 40% total in the caliphate. So my first question is, whither ISIS? How does this play out? What does the conflict look like? And looking as much forward as you can.
Thank you. And first of all, Robin, congratulations to you and your team for pulling this together. We spent days arguing with each other, and the fact that she was able to distill it down to this is remarkable. It's also remarkable to see how far the star of ISIS has fallen. From its high point of just 2 years ago. Remember when it declared its caliphate, so-called, in the summer of 2014. It controlled the lives of some 5 million people, a territory estimated to be the size of the United Kingdom, a war chest, some estimated at $2 billion. To go from that high to this low of having lost nearly half its territory, it's the two poles in the tent of the ISIS caliphate. Mosul in Iraq, Raqqa in Syria are both under extreme duress, and the organization itself is crumbling. It has taken a beating. The US intelligence estimate that circulated in the news last week was something on the level of 50,000 ISIS fighters have died. To put that in context, US casualties, fatalities in the Vietnam War were about 58,000, so it's approaching that level. Think of the shock that sent through the American political system. You have to anticipate something similar is happening in ISIS. The more its territory shrinks, the smaller its tax base, the less money it can pay fighters. So all of the death and the dwindling salaries mean that there is going to be a lot of infighting in the organization. And it's telling that Baghdadi himself had to issue a rare statement calling on his fighters to stand and fight in Mosul because the worry was that some of them were going to bleed away. And they have stood firm. Nobody thinks they will hold the territory in the long term, but they're fighting for it now. So signs look good in terms of the organizations crumbling in Syria and Iraq as a statelet, as a government. I don't think anybody, certainly not in our group, anticipates that the organization will just fade away if it loses its main cities. It will remain a fierce insurgency. The politics, the underlying politics in Syria and Iraq cut against an easy settlement of this conflict, and ISIS will be there to exploit it. And the history of the organization tells us something about what it is going to do in the near term in Syria and Iraq. When it was beaten as an insurgency in 2008, it still remained one of the world's most formidable terror organizations and killed, according to one estimate, something like 2,000 people in the intervening 3 years before it appeared in the open again. 2,000 people who had participated in the Anbar awakenings, and this was ISIS preparing the ground again for a comeback. This is also the period when you had a number of prison breaks to free personnel and high-profile terror attacks to stay in the forefront of the minds of the global jihadist community so it could continue to recruit. So one anticipates that the organization will attempt something similar in the coming years if it loses its government in the Sunni hinterland between Syria and Iraq.
We'll come back to that in a minute then. One of the most interesting trends we talked about was the evolution of Al-Qaeda, once the vanguard of Sunni jihadism, and how it's jockeying once again for primacy, and how its long game may end up proving more durable than the ISIS plan. And so I want to ask David, let's take a look at Al-Qaeda. What happens to it? How does this play out, particularly given that ISIS appears to be losing territory and the kind of momentum it's dominated the jihadi scene for the last couple of years, but that's fading. What happens and what's Al-Qaeda doing? And looking forward particularly.
First of all, Robin, just as Will did, I'd like to congratulate you on a remarkable report. I've been a part of a number of working groups and based on past experience, tend to avoid them like the plague. In this case, I wanted to take part because of my belief in you, and I'm not disappointed. I think it's a tremendous final product. You mentioned a trend towards increasing extremism over time. I'd certainly divide extremism between strategic extremism and extremism in use of tactics. I think that ISIS and Al-Qaeda are basically equally extreme in terms of their long-term vision, but ISIS has by far the more brutal tactics. Now, Will said, and I agree entirely, that ISIS's star has fallen dramatically. I would contend that the fall of ISIS's star was eminently predictable. And we know this because this is what I've been saying for the past couple of years. And I know that Al-Qaeda certainly saw the same thing. ISIS's strategy, just put bluntly, was terrible. Their strategy was to make enemies, then make more enemies, then continue to make enemies. They immediately betrayed the various groups who were part of their coalition, groups like Jaish Rizal Tariqat Naqshbandiya, or JRTN, who they started to round up almost immediately after their offensive that took ground in Iraq. They attacked groups who weren't at war with them, such as the Kurdish regional government, which opened up new fronts. They tried to commit genocide against groups that were militarily irrelevant, like the Yazidis, and that drew in increasing resources to the fight against ISIS. So Al-Qaeda saw it coming. And part of what they did was played off of two different factors that were gripping the region. One was the rise of ISIS. They would play up ISIS's strength, ironically, just as ISIS was playing up their own strength. There's a really interesting interview that I encourage everyone to look at, which was given to The Guardian last summer. In this interview, Abu Qatada, Abu Muhammad al-Maqdisi, who were both out of prison, talked about how Al-Qaeda had been destroyed by ISIS. basically that Zawahiri had already lost control of al-Qaeda, and then ISIS came along and al-Qaeda was splintered apart. Now, one could see at the time that al-Qaeda was in a very strong position. They controlled territory in multiple countries. Their comeback was very clear, but Abu Qatada and Meqdisi were talking about how their organization had been splintered. It was in line with a lot of the narratives coming out of analytic communities in the West, but just a brilliant psyop on their part. They also played off of the Iran GCC competition and continue to do so to this day. The Syria conflict, a large part of that story is the conflict between Iran and the GCC, with, of course, Assad being aligned with Iran and GCC states helping to support the opposition, including the opposition that's dominated by al-Qaeda. So, yes, al-Qaeda is making a comeback, and we can see that across multiple theaters. We can see that in Syria, where one of the consensus views in this group with very divergent opinions on some issues was that Jabhat Fateh al-Sham, or successor of Nusra, didn't have any sort of real split from al-Qaeda. Now, what their nominal split will do to the organization can be debated, but ultimately the group agreed that there are still links between them. They're one of the strongest militant factions in Syria today. There's Yemen, where al-Qaeda continues to control territory along the coastline, hundreds of miles. There's Libya, where within the group people didn't agree on the extent of connection between groups like the Derna Mujahideen Shura Council or the Benghazi Revolutionary Brigade and al-Qaeda Central, but they certainly do proclaim connections to them. Then there's Mali and Somalia, in both of which you have an increasing insurgency where al-Qaeda is at the center of it. In Somalia, it's their affiliate Shabab. But the biggest factor to me, in addition to the fact that we can see this comeback on the ground, is the fact that al-Qaeda can just operate far more openly now than it ever has before. They're receiving state support in Syria. This isn't even obscured. And in other places, like Yemen, Libya, they're able to control territory without anybody really being particularly bothered by it. A lot of the charity organizations, the networks that the U.S. and others worked so hard to shut down just after 9/11 that were helping al-Qaeda, are essentially back in business, and that there are organizations now which are giving aid to this jihadist group, and it's happening in the open. This is something that the new administration is going to have to deal with, and I think we're not that far from this being something that media catches up to and starts to say, oh my God, al-Qaeda is operating openly again.
Can I ask you just for 1 minute to talk about how al-Qaeda has deployed a lot of the officials who were in Afghanistan and Pakistan and embedded them with local groups? And that's one of the most important things in understanding why Nusra's strategy, how it's been effective, and how and why it hasn't really separated from al-Qaeda. Because this is really a tremendously important strategy that hasn't been widely recognized, I think, in the outside world.
Absolutely. The most prominent example of this is in Syria is the Khorasan group, which is a group of al-Qaeda senior leaders who are called the Khorasan group because they moved in from South Asia, the region which al-Qaeda refers to as the Khorasan region. They were embedded with a few different organizations, including Nusra, Ahrar-e-Sham, and continue to operate in Syria to this day. One thing that I think is an important trend about al-Qaeda leadership is often when we talk about al-Qaeda core, al-Qaeda senior leadership, we think of them as being confined to South Asia, but increasingly it's geographically diffuse. In places like Syria, places like Yemen, you've seen very prominent examples, including in Yemen, the late Nasser al-Wahishi was serving as the deputy commander of al-Qaeda at the same time that he was also an official within al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula. So that's a trend, and one that potentially provides much greater ability for al-Qaeda core to provide guidance to multiple affiliates at the same time.
Well, that's a logical segue to Fred. It's very interesting. ISIS has 37 provinces, as they like to call them, in 8 different countries. Al-Qaeda, and of course, most of them are very, most of them, not all of them, are fairly young. Al-Qaeda has 5 transnational branches. And so I'd be very interested in having you take a look at how important are these franchises for the future of jihadism. We saw recently in Libya, a country you spent a lot of time in, that ISIS first colony has actually kind of disappeared. So the question is, you know, how do they regroup when none of us are going to write them off? And how, you know, how central is the central leadership in determining what the strategy is? Because my sense is that this was a movement until 2 years ago, ISIS and Al-Qaeda were the same thing. And now they're effectively rivals for influence. They're scrambling to try to get more and more of their own affiliates to build up their profiles. So talk a little bit about the franchises and their role and their future.
Well, I think the affiliates are increasingly important, and the center of gravity, as the report concludes, is shifting to the affiliates. But I think this distinction between affiliates and the center, as David mentioned, is becoming blurred because of the dispersal of leadership, of power. The affiliates are the reach. They're the global reach. They lend expertise, fighters, funds to what would otherwise be very, very localized insurgencies. So in that respect, they're incredibly important. From a U.S. policy perspective, they're only as important as we deem the certain countries where they are important and certain fronts. So again, if an affiliate emerges in a fairly remote location, is contained, obviously there's questions about plotting and this sort of thing, but within the sort of hierarchy of interest, we have to make that determination. I think we have to distinguish between, you know, aspirational versus the actual, in the sense that we've seen multiple instances where the brand is exported to a certain locale, to a certain front, but it's tempered by local realities. And Al-Qaeda, there's numerous lessons learned about this from the Horn of Africa to elsewhere. They run into certain local realities in the insurgency, whether tribes, whether sociological symptoms, you know, various political realities that shape their strategy and their targeting. So again, this embedding can only get them so far. Again, in terms of a place like Libya, you know, it responded to a Libyan context. Why did it emerge where it did? Insert it because it was a seam area. This is what I like to call a seam area, where there's a locale that falls between two certain political blocks, whether Mosul, whether Sinai, northern Nigeria. I mean, these are the real areas of growth for the affiliates. You know, again, I think in terms of their determination of strategy, we've seen multiple cases where it's bounded by these local factors.
Okay, so let me ask you to kind of take a look at Al-Qaeda versus ISIS. Mm-hmm. Which group has more effective franchises? And maybe talk about some of the ones you think are the most dangerous, looking into the future, mm-hmm. which have the most potential. We've seen, for example, the Sinai province shot down the metro line, the metro jet, the Russian metro jet. I'm trying to think of the other one that's higher profile, but you know, talk about the ones, kind of compare them and their potential.
Well, I think our report concludes that Al-Qaeda has the more durable, sustainable franchise strategy. I mean, this reconfiguration of their brand, I mean, post-Zarqawi, Muqtasi, with Ansar al-Sharia, we saw it in Libya, that rested on a you know, using political flexibility as a virtue, where they would form these alliances with different militias, focus on Dawah first. This attempt at moderation, I think, does lend them some sustainability, but it's also a liability, I think, in terms of, and the report addresses this, if you dilute your, you know, jihadist project so much and you become so localized, that impacts your ability to form you know, a sovereign state, to conduct operations. You have to make sort of compromises with local groups. It creates dissent within the leadership. So again, I mean, Al-Qaeda, I think, is a long-term threat to the regional order. It's going to be with us for a long time, as is jihadism as a project. But, you know, from a policy perspective, we have to determine, I mean, again, this country-first approach versus transnational, and where does Al-Qaeda fit into that? Look, the report says so many of the leadership from these different groups have come from Egyptians. I'm very worried about the Egyptian affiliate. I'm very worried about Sinai. Again, what did it start as? A localized Bedouin insurgency, the product of peripheral marginalization. It was very quickly hijacked, embedded by this transnational group that now is shooting down airliners. The Sisi regime approach is, I think, very counterproductive. We can talk about that later. AQAP is going to be with us as well. I mean, the carving out of territory that David mentioned.
Al-Qaeda of the Arabian Peninsula.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Yes. I think that's very worrisome, given what we know about their leadership, that some of their leadership has actually subsumed the Al-Qaeda central leaderships.
One of the things that David mentioned, I should have pointed out, is that Al-Qaeda, because of the brutality of ISIS, comes away looking as more, I hate to use the word moderate, but more willing to work within systems and not simply kill everybody around them. Now, it doesn't mean they have different goals down the road, but the fact is that suddenly Al-Qaeda attracts people who are interested in jihad but don't necessarily want to kill everybody. So let me turn to Hassan. As I mentioned earlier, ISIS and Al-Qaeda were one movement until 2014, and they pose complementary threats now to global security. So my fourth question is, whether jihadism generally, how does this trend evolve? We've been surprised over and over again for all the energy and time and resources we pour into this, into understanding it. If you're looking down the road, 5 years, 10 years, how do you see jihadism evolve? And what are the kind of issues that trigger it?
Absolutely. I agree with Fred. He just mentioned that jihadism is here to stay. And I completely agree with that. I think the wave is in favor of jihadism. Even if jihadists lose the war, as ISIS might be losing the war now, but I think jihadism will win in the same way that Islamism over the past few decades won the war in the sense that their narrative, their appeal, their relevance is still there and it's still entrenched, even if Muslim Brotherhood organization didn't make it to power or they lost power or they were challenged by or their power was limited. I follow the kind of the intellectual debate or the side of jihadism as well as how the groups operate and what these groups do on the ground. And the word you just mentioned about moderation, how Al-Qaeda, for example, present themselves as a moderate group. I remember kind of about 2 years ago, there was a full report of kind of a very long, just pasted, I think, jihadist article saying, actually going back to 2012 and narrating, talking about how jihadism became irrelevant in 2012 and 2011 with the Arab revolts. And they say that it was jihadists across the world. This is like an insider talking. They felt under threat. They felt that they're no longer as relevant as they wanted to be. And then he continues. He said, with the rise of ISIS and kind of also Islamists post Arab Spring, we started to see another trend, which is one extreme like ISIS conducting their kind of or kind of trying to reach power through savagery and through brutal tactics. And you have Islamists who also sold the cause. You know, people who are trying to get to power. They are politically engaged, but they're not getting anywhere. And he said Al-Qaeda saw an opening there again. And they said they start to present themselves as wasati, as moderate, as intermediate, as a kind of a media, kind of a middle way movement. And they say we started to kind of push towards that, to present ourselves as a way, a middle way between ISIS and Islamists. And that was actually, that worked for a while. And that's why you started to see that kind of cyclical or cycle of analysis where by also academics were saying, Al-Qaeda was dead in 2012. People wrote books about that, saying Al-Qaeda was done. And then later, you started to see another trend of saying Al-Qaeda is rising again, or Al-Qaeda is stronger than ever before. And then with the rise of ISIS, people started to say, the rise of ISIS is actually an opportunity for us, because that means Al-Qaeda is going to be weakened and is going to be uprooted by this new trend, which is easier to deal with because it's so brutal, so people can't actually rally against it. But I think, to go back to your question, I think there is a danger in there, which is not to see these two groups as two threats, different threats that benefit from different spaces, and they're going to continue to thrive despite the different constraints and despite also their rivalry. ISIS, for example, their strategy is Nikaya, and they have a proven Nikaya, which is a word that they use, which means a war of attrition. I think it's similar to a war of attrition. And Al-Qaeda also uses a word that is similar, but it means a kind of a gradual popularization of the idea of jihad. So they're really working on two fronts, and these two fronts, unless you deal with the two fronts at the same time, you're not going to deal with these two threats down the road. And Nikaya, for example, the ISIS strategy worked in Iraq. Back like just a decade ago, you had numerous jihadists or Islamists or even nationalist insurgent groups that represent Sunnis. You know, if you're Sunni, you have diverse options. If you're a Sunni and believe in violence, you have a diverse choices, a diverse kind of diversity of choices. Today, you don't have except ISIS. If you're a Sunni in Iraq who doesn't believe in the political system, who is opposed to the Iranian kind of hegemony in Iraq, who doesn't believe that you need to work with the Kurds and so on and so forth, you only have ISIS, right? And this is reality. This is what Iraqis talk about, and this is why ISIS is more comfortable today to pursue violence in the same way they as much as they want, because they know that even if they lose ground, they're going to go back, and there's a vacuum they can fill anytime they want. Al-Qaeda, at the same time, is pursuing this kind of a quiet front where they can embed with other organizations, they can camouflage, they can look different, they don't have to be looking like Al-Qaeda. And that's what Al-Qaeda in Syria is doing. That's what Al-Qaeda in Yemen is doing. And I worry that every time you find a place where Al-Qaeda is quiet, know that it's more dangerous than the noisy Al-Qaeda. And that's why I think people exaggerate when they say Al-Qaeda in Syria is the most successful organization. I think the most successful organization, or maybe dangerous, or something I don't know about, it might be even more dangerous or less dangerous than I think, is the one in Yemen, maybe also in Libya. So I think to just conclude, we have to look at the two threats or the two organizations as two fronts, and you have to deal with them differently.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things we point out in the report is that they both ultimately want the same thing, and that's creation of a caliphate. They just go about it in terms of different strategies. Al-Qaeda is for building up and educating a Muslim population so that they eventually willingly embrace the idea of a caliphate, whereas ISIS goes in and is going to impose a caliphate and kill anybody who disagrees. And so ultimately, they represent the same kind of threat. Back to Will, one of the things that was very striking about our report was how we found how diverse jihadism has become, and that it's not just Al-Qaeda and ISIS, it's not just the dangerous duo, it's also kind of diversity. For example, there are those who invoke the globalist jihadi rhetoric, and there are others who invoke just the local, the country first, as we call them. And so there's a diversity in terms of where your priority is, what your focus is, what your resource base is. And there's also something, it's a really important term to understand in the future of jihadism, and that's the term marble or marbling. And this is the intersection of global jihadi groups with local jihadi groups, and the relationships ebb and flow. They cut in and out like marbling. As is strategically or financially expedient. So maybe you can kind of explain both trends and how that's changing the face of jihadism. Mm-hmm.
Right, I want to pick up a thread that Hassan mentioned, and that is what the world looked like before 2011 if you were a jihadist. It didn't look good. It did not look like things were going your way. And this is when Obama's administration made the very confident assessment that they had beat al-Qaeda strategically. It looks laughable now, but at the time, that organization and others had not been able to make many inroads because the Middle East and North Africa was largely stable. Fast forward to 3 years later, when the wheels come off the bus. All of this state failure in the region has really been the fuel and the engine that is driving the jihadist resurgence, and in many ways has provided the grotesque laboratory for the Darwinian experiment that leads to the hybridization, or the marbling, as Robin says, where you see different groups in a theater of conflict who are experimenting. And they're positioning themselves against one another, against a regime, against competitors. The longer those conflicts go on, the more diversity you have, of course. And some of these experiments succeed wildly for a time, and others fail. And then you will have a complete reversal. And what's happened because of these conflicts over the last 5 years in so many different theaters at the same time is that you've had a tremendous amount of diversity in the jihadist community that has resulted. So you have the global jihadists who are serious about their taking on the far enemy, as it were. For example, Al-Qaeda Central still carries that flag, but itself has also really pushed the local stuff, whereas under bin Laden, it was de-emphasized. So now they have a hybrid that they've worked with. ISIS speaks the global jihadist language, but for a long time just focused on the local stuff, but has now been pushed to expand globally, partly because it is trying to cope with this onset and alleviate pressure on itself. Then you have groups like Ahrar al-Sham in Syria, which uses a lot of the same rhetoric as the global jihadists, but they have disavowed the global jihad. They say we're only fighting for nationalist goals, we're focused only in Syria, we don't have broader ambitions. You have a variety of Ansar groups in different countries that also speak the language of global jihad, but are focused locally. So you have this broad spectrum now of groups that use a variety of tactics and strategy in response to the turmoil that they are confronting and the problem that presents to policymakers and especially to the incoming administration is, who do you deal with? Do you go and fight everyone? Is it a war on all fronts? Do you have the resources to do that? And what does a real fight look like? Is it just using special forces and air power? Or is it a more sustained commitment on the ground? And which enemies do you want to make? I mean, what's being contemplated right now among some in the Trump orbit is even going after the Muslim Brotherhood, which parts of the organization have dabbled with violence, many parts of the organization have not. These are difficult questions that are going to confront the incoming administration because it is one, hard to determine what the real priorities of many of these jihadist groups are because their rhetoric is confusing. And even if you can determine it through careful analysis or intelligence, do you want to pick that fight preemptively or do you want to wait for them to come to you? And there are dozens, hundreds of these groups now, and each one will require its own careful assessment. And by the time the bureaucracy is able to render a verdict, those groups will have splintered. There will be a new cast of characters. The situation, Robin, is moving so quickly. And the diversity and this marbling that you're talking about is happening so fast. It's difficult for a large government like the United States to respond nimbly and with the right set of priorities.
One of the best examples of marbling is actually the Nusra Front in Syria. This is a group that emerged when seven Syrians were dispatched by Baghdadi to Syria to form a kind of logistics cell, and it became its own little branch. And it ultimately broke away from ISIS because it wanted to focus locally. And it believed that the first task was ousting Assad, not carrying out ISIS agenda. So it pledged loyalty to Al-Qaeda. And along the way, that became so volatile in terms of achieving the kind of cooperation they needed with local Syrian groups that in, I think it was June or July this year, it rebranded itself and took a new name and said it's not involved in any with any external groups. Well, it was all a sham because at the end of the day, Al-Qaeda had embedded at least two dozen of their own leaders in with Nusra. The United States killed two of them this fall in airstrikes. And so this is this ebb and flow, the ability of these groups to morph and evolve and adapt in ways that we often can't keep up with. And we saw it happen yet again this weekend with Ahrar al-Sham. So David, let me ask you, Sunni extremist movements have proliferated at a time that governments across the region are weaker or are frail. And the traditional forms of authority, the traditional forms of identity, are being redefined or challenges. And so as a result, the region both politically and physically is vulnerable. So looking ahead, how does this intersection between frail states and jihadism play out? How does it shape the future?
Well, first of all, let me congratulate the panel on its restraint for talking about nationalism versus globalism in the jihadist context without referencing domestic politics. So the question is,
that wasn't our agenda.
Will the weakening states make ISIS great again? And the answer is maybe. Look, the trend towards weakening states in the regions we're talking about, North Africa and the Middle East in particular, as well as sub-Saharan Africa, is not going to reverse. You have clear ecological problems. If you just look at satellite images of Africa, you can see within a few years the degree to which desertification has massively increased in the continent. Lay on top of that political systems that aren't working particularly well. Corruption is endemic, and even when you have new governments come into power who want to clear out that corruption, it's very difficult to do due to path dependency. Nigeria is a very good example of that, where it's hard to disentangle past mistakes, past corruption. You have financial crises, which are gripping the regions, but also obviously gripping Western states, which makes it much more difficult to step in with aid. One thing I focus on, and something we talk about in the report, is internet penetration. Obviously, the rise of ISIS, the mass mobilization that came so quickly, which Robin referred to in her opening remarks, is tied to their facility with the internet. But in these critical regions, internet penetration remains very low. It's, in Africa right now, 29%. It's 53% in the Middle East and about 27%, I believe, in South Asia. More and more people are going to get online. One thing that's really interesting is going back to social science in the 1990s, which talked about the impact of computer-mediated communication. Back then in the 1990s, and you had about 14% internet penetration in the US in 1995. Back then, people were studying chat groups where people could go online and talk about the fact that they were gay, or that they were anorexic, or that they were white nationalists. And in all of those cases, all three of those, though they're very different, have one thing in common, which is that all of them are what you could call marginalized and concealable identities. Marginalized in that they're frowned upon by society, and concealable in that you can't tell, looking at somebody, that they're a white nationalist, or that they're anorexic, or that they're gay. You can tell if someone's a member of a racial minority group, but not those other identities. And so if you look at the identities that have been brought out, both in the jihadist sphere and beyond, recent attention being focused on white nationalism, And you know, globally, you can see very similar phenomena, where mobilization to these various causes becomes easier. Now, I think that when we look at violent extremism today and use of the internet, we tend to look at it through the frame of ISIS mobilizing. You're also going to see other movements mobilizing in Africa and the Middle East, which aren't, people in those countries aren't accustomed to. I think LGBT identity is going to be one, because that's the logic of computer-mediated communication. People will be more outspoken about minority sexual identities in a number of countries that aren't used to that. Atheism, in my view, is going to be another. You're going to see traditional identities increasingly threatened. Furthermore, social media makes it far easier to destabilize a government, to make it harder to govern. I was in Southern Africa, in Namibia, late last year, when you had South Africa cities shut down by protests against a rise in university fees. And I had the privilege of talking to some old anti-apartheid activists who said, you know, there was no comparison at all. Like, the speed of mobilization to protest apartheid was so much less than the speed of mobilization to protest an increase in university fees. And that's because of different media. Right? On the one hand, against apartheid, you'd mobilize house to house. It was very slow. Against university fees, you could just throw up a hashtag and people will come out and they can shut down entire cities. So the whole process, the whole mechanism of combating violent extremism and how violent extremists mobilize is going to look so much more complex in a short period of time, because you're not just going to have violent extremist mobilization, but debates are going to be racking countries in these regions at the same time that governance becomes more difficult, that governments become weaker, and ISIS, Al-Qaeda, jihadism, in my view, looking forward about 10 years, has to be understood against that increasingly complex backdrop.
Interesting. We're going to open up to questions in just a minute, but I want to ask both one last one for both Hassan and Fred. And I'm going to skip to Hassan because we're going to pick up on the what we call the drivers or the conditions that enable jihadism. And we talked about a lot of them in the report. There's six major ones, whether it's ideology or, in some cases, the absence of alternative ideologies, demographics, technology that David's already covered, the issue of foreign intervention. And we found a direct correlation between the level of foreign intervention and the response and the growth of jihadism. Can you talk a little bit about what factors you think are particularly important in looking down the road, the drivers that will enable or spur or inspire jihadism down the road?
Thank you. I'll blame David for bringing the domestic analogy, but I think ISIS, kind of, especially if we're focused on ISIS, the kind of the mantra that ISIS has is similar to Sunnis over the past century have not been winning. They're losing on all fronts, and they say
even though they're the vast majority, 90%
exactly,
of the
exactly yeah
that of the Arab
key,
world.
That's mm-hmm. a key thing there. And they say, if you join us, you would be winning so much, you'll be tired of winning. And I think that's really kind of what defines ISIS narrative over the past few years. And if you go back, for example, to the post 2008 when they were defeated in Iraq, and I think this period is very important, and everyone has done work on that. Because it will tell us what's going to happen next. And one of the things we mentioned in the report, this strategy of ISIS called inhiyaz, or retreat into the desert. And they say they have been talking about it for seven months now, right? Since May, they've been talking about that this is our fallback strategy. We can lose Sirte, we can lose Mosul, we can lose Raqqa, but we're going to go back to the desert. And the win in Palmyra yesterday is an example of that. That's what ISIS can and cannot do. But to go back to that kind of 2008, ISIS launched a campaign similar, or ISIS kind of version of degrade and ultimately destroy the Iraqi state. And they launched that campaign through a campaign of terror. They say when we retreated into the desert, we went to the Anbar Desert, we left behind what they call in Arabic, Mafariz Amniya, or security agents, sleeper cells kind of thing. And they said, we went back, we went after everyone who had fought us with the Americans, with the Iraqi government. These are Sunni insurgents that were the Awakening Council's members. And they said, we started that campaign of degrading and really going after all the people who posed a threat to us and will pose a threat to us. And, then they said, when we, in 2014, when we came back and took Mosul, we had like a major space, a major vacuum to operate in. And there were not enough Sunni rivals to really push us back. And that's why the Americans and the Iraqi government had to bring people from the south, from elsewhere, to really fight in Fallujah and Tikrit and in Mosul now, rather than from Mosul, Fallujah, and Tikrit. And I think this is one of the drivers, which is that ISIS presents itself as an alternative, as an option for Sunnis. Al Qaeda does the same, but does it more smartly through kind of engagement with the populace and so on and so forth. But just to name the six drivers, the six factors that ISIS. Enabled ISIS rise, which is that campaign of degradation. The prison breaks were also an important thing. ISIS uses prisons the same also way that jihadists use prisons for indoctrination of creating the ideological monsters that we see in the Middle East. Also, another factor was the policies that Nour al-Maliki, the previous prime minister of Iraq, followed in Iraq, which is kind of a sectarian type of policies. He went after the Sunni politicians who would otherwise create an alternative for Sunnis to be part of the Iraqi government. And then he had also the withdrawal of the American troops. That was a major factor because the Americans withdrew at a time when the Iraqi government already was degrading, was eroding, and the Sunni fighters who fought ISIS also started to go away. And then the last factor was the Syrian uprising. And you all know the kind of the rest of the story enabled ISIS to go back from Iraq to Syria and from Syria back into Iraq.
Thanks. Just wanted to point out that one thing that struck me, having been through the region this fall, is how the Sunnis, who've dominated, whether it's through monarchies or autocratic rule, the Arab world for 14 centuries, now feel like the new Shiites. They feel marginalized. And it struck me everywhere I went, talking to whether it was sheikhs or the young, that they said there's no leadership. There's not a country that we look at, an ideology as an alternative, an individual. There's this vacuum. And that's, I think, one of the most important drivers. And this prison phenomena can't be underrated. It really is huge in taking kids who may have been, you know, on the margins, may have been picked up for some minor crime, and they get exposed to people who they think will protect them. I do want to leave some time for questions, so just, Fred, if you could deal our last question, and that is, in 6 weeks we have a new administration taking office, and it will inherit an incredibly complex array of challenges in this world of jihadism. Can you give us some of the considerations that it is going to have to factor in when it takes office?
Right. I mean, one of the virtues of the report is that it identifies, terrorism is ultimately and fundamentally a political, strategy. So counterterrorism has to be connected to politics. And in that sense, our strategy in the region, the strategy of the incoming administration, has to be connected to regional realities. And I think the first consideration is an appreciation for the fundamental tumult that's going on in this region. It's unprecedented. Perhaps we haven't seen it since 67, perhaps earlier, the post-Ottoman era. This is a region that's collapsing on itself, four civil wars, collapsed states, a shrinking space for civil society. The states that are still standing in the region are under tremendous pressure we're entering, I think, what we can call the post-Rentier era, an era of low oil prices. So their resources to deal with the tremendous societal demands that are bubbling up from below are limited. They haven't realized the game yet. They haven't figured out what to do next. The biggest population displacement since World War II. We're creating a huge crisis of dislocation. And we don't know what the full effects of that will be generationally. So these are tremendous realities. The rising sectarianism that you mentioned, the Cold War between Iran and Saudi Arabia. Now, with that in mind, I would just put forward another principle, and that's that context matters. Our report talks about the very localized drivers, the localized constraints on jihadism. So sweeping pronouncements about certain groups, sweeping prescriptions, I think will be fundamentally counterproductive. And that goes to the point that Will raised about the Brotherhood. I mean, the Brotherhood is ultimately an expression of certain realities from which it emerged. So it's different in Egypt, it's different in Syria, it's different in Tunisia. It's a product of Arab political culture, its behavior. And so that granularity, I think, is absolutely essential. The third consideration, again, it may seem trite, it may seem basic, but I'm going to put it out there. It's not about Islam. Again, a lot of ink spilled on this. From my perspective, this focus on ideology, this focus on promoting the correct form of Islam is a boon to certain authoritarian actors in the region that can suddenly advance certain programs, whether surveillance of mosques, whether putting forward certain clerical figures who really don't have much credibility in the first place, while ignoring the hard tasks of reform and restructuring their societies, restructuring their rule, addressing the fundamental drivers of discontent. So again, be wary of this focus on moderate Islam. The fourth one is this buzzword of local ownership. It's not simply about local ownership. It has to be about local ownership with this long-term focus on governance. Many states would be more than happy to own the terrorism problem because they're often using it instrumentally to secure their own rule. They're going after legitimate political dissent. And then there's the question of partnership that Will raised. Who do we actually partner with in these states that are collapsing? Do we partner with the Kurds? Do we partner with the Misratah militias who attack Sirte? And what are the follow-on challenges that present to state cohesion and state unity? I think the report also very nicely emphasizes policy realism. And if I was to urge the administration to read a book, well, there's many books I would urge them to read, Will's and others, and of course yours. But there's one, it's an older book, it's not on terrorism. It's by Lawrence Friedman called A Choice of Enemies. And it's about the US experience in the Middle East. And listen to that title, A Choice of Enemies. We've been confronted for centuries. And so policy realism. Are we going to go after all the Al-Qaeda affiliates, all the brand? Are we going to defeat jihadism as a lifestyle, as a counterculture, as a profession? No, we're not. We're not going to defeat illiberalism. We're not going to defeat radicalism. So again, prioritization. The last one, and again, there's another great sentence in the report. I would like to claim credit for it, but I don't think it was mine. The jihadist agenda will be defined by Western intervention or Western action. Again, the conflicts that have opened up in the region that have attracted jihadism were often of the consequence of Western intervention. And there's another piece that I would raise, going back to this sort of fundamental, this classic article of terrorism, 1975, David Fromkin's article in Foreign Affairs, The Strategy of Terrorism, when this was first arising. He again, terrorism is a strategy designed to provoke an adversary into doing something that is against their interests. So I think that's absolutely fundamental to remember.
We only have 5 minutes for questions, so why don't we take two and we'll get the group to respond. There are microphones on the side. So I think Marina's got her hand up, right? Let's take one from Marina. And one down here.
Okay, thank you for a very interesting discussion. I'd like the panel to address the issue of the medium-term strategies or likely strategies of this organization, because it's easier to understand the short run, and you have talked a lot about this in this post post-ISIS caliphate period. The long term, as you said, is the creation of a real caliphate that can last and so on. But how do you go from this present phase of reorganization, of withdrawing to the desert, of recruiting, of finding ways for this organization to work or not work together in different ways, to the goal of getting to a caliphate? In other words, what is the next step?
Okay, and let's take, he has a question, let's take them both.
Thank you very much. My question is kind of going back on talking about social media and kind of what Mr. Gerdenstein-Ross and others were talking about self-isolating, or like communities that find other like kind of hidden members through social media. Kind of comparing that with what we've seen in the recent American elections, where we have like so-called like a red feed and a blue feed when it comes to political parties, and how those are kind of mutually like almost radicalizing.
What is your question?
Do you think that that kind of phenomenon will happen in as different jihadist groups are competing for legitimacy? Are we going to see extremism?
We've only got 3 minutes to answer. So, Will, you want to take the first one?
Yep. So it's interesting. I think in the midterm, it seems that in some ways, Al-Qaeda and ISIS have switched positions in terms of focus of attack. For ISIS, I think the priority, once they lose their government, will be attacks abroad to try and stay in the jihadist public eye, to continue momentum, to continue to recruit. Conversely, as David's talked about, I think for Al-Qaeda, particularly among the affiliates, it's a strategy of trying to blend in, not getting the notice of the United States, as a strategy for trying to advance their political objectives in the region.
Great. David, do you want to take the second part on?
Sure. In terms of different jihadist or extremist feeds, absolutely. We can see that happening for a variety of reasons. But I'd say the biggest reason is the expulsion of militant groups, especially ISIS, from Twitter. On Twitter, it was very easy for ISIS to talk to non-jihadists, but also for jihadists to talk to each other. Now, with the migration to Telegram, you'll have channels that are dedicated to a group, as opposed to the cross-pollination. That's at least a short to medium-term trend. It's possible that you'll have other platforms emerge that are more open for jihadists to communicate with each other.
I want to thank my co-panelists, for just an extraordinary conversation and a really enlightening report. There are copies for all of you on the front table. Anyone who'd like to see it, please join me in thanking Will, David, Fred, and Hassan.
Good morning, everyone. We're a little bit ahead of schedule, actually. Our next panel is supposed to start at 10:30, but please stay. I see a lot of people getting up to leave right now. So my name is Georgia Holmer. I'm the director of CVE here at USIP. And in our next panel, we're going to be focusing explicitly on efforts to prevent and counter violent extremism. So our previous panel made very clear how interconnected and fluid and complex and indeed marbled the relationships are between many of these extremist groups in the Middle East and North Africa, and really the scope of their reach and impact and the complexity of the dynamics that enable them. And they spoke a little bit about the fragility and the weakening states that really enable these groups to thrive. So how do we stay ahead of the curve then? How do we support a comprehensive and sustainable strategy given the complexity and the politicized nature of both the threat and our capacity to respond to it? We're very fortunate this morning to have several distinguished experts with us on our panel, and I just need your patience while they join us. They're getting their microphones on right now. So we just wait 2 minutes, and they should be coming shortly. I unfortunately did not plan a song and dance interlude for you for this unexpected break in our program, so please bear with us just a moment. My title is Director of Countering Violent Extremism, and USIP is very focused on violent extremism as being a significant driver of conflict, as being a component of a lot of the conflict we deal with. And we've spent a lot of resources and energy on understanding how a lot of these violent extremist groups actually intersect with some of the more traditional sectarian conflicts that we deal with. And a lot of our work is very much focused on determining what peace-building methodologies, and by that a lot of the traditional tools that we have in our peace-building box, like dialogue and reform and especially police reform, conflict resolution skills, are tailored and applied for CVE purposes and CVE objectives. And this is something we've been exploring and trying to do as in an innovative and creative way as possible over the past couple of years. And we have some very interesting learning coming out from these interventions, which we'll share with you at another time. for your patience. So we had a little bit of a delay there, and grateful for the musical interlude that we had. All right. Well, we're very fortunate this morning to have a very distinguished panel of experts with us to discuss what's worked and where we need to continue to improve in our effort to develop effective and smart and sustainable approaches to this ever-evolving threat of violent extremism. I'd like to start by introducing Amy Pope, who is the Deputy Assistant to the President and the Department of Homeland Security Advisor on the National Security Council staff of the White House. We are still expecting Undersecretary Sarah Sewell. She hasn't yet arrived, but hopefully she'll join us, and I'll introduce her when she does come. Shannon Green is the Director and Senior Fellow of the Human Rights Initiative at the Center for Strategic and International Studies. And last but not least, we have Eric Rezand, who's the Director of the Prevention Project and a non-resident senior fellow at the Brookings Institution. So, let's start the second half of the discussion. You know, we're all very aware of the expansion of US institutions and policy and legislation and strategies that emerged in response to 9/11. But we really have witnessed a second wave of effort focused on prevention in the past 2 years, one that really represents a paradigm shift in our approach to addressing violent extremism, and which has an emphasis on addressing root causes that looks to reduce the appeal of recruitment and vulnerability to radicalization. The White House Summit on CVE in February 2015 and the United Nations Plan of Action on Preventing Violent Extremism, which was issued in 2016, really represent pivotal events in advancing and consolidating this more comprehensive and prevention-focused approach to this issue. Ms. Pope, let's start with you. Can you help us understand how our approach to the challenge of violent extremism has evolved in this past administration? What are some of the central features of it?
First of all, thank you for having me here. It's a real pleasure to be here and to discuss this important conversation at such a pivotal moment in our history. And I want to thank all of you who are here to listen in. It's important that we have a well-informed community of people talking through these issues. I'd say there are a number of ways in which the president's strategy on countering violent extremism has evolved over the past 8 years. First is the recognition that countering violent extremism is an important part of our response to terrorism, that our response to terrorism can't just be focused on what we're doing in theater outside of the United States. It can't just be focused on bombs and intelligence collection, that we really need to address the root causes of what's happening with terrorism. And that's really the idea behind what we're doing here. It's to identify what causes people to radicalize to violence, what's behind it, and what can responsible governments and communities do about it. So over the course of the past 8 years, we've seen the first ever development of a strategy on violent extremism. And that really focused on communities as being at the heart of the solution, that governments acting alone are not trusted actors all of the time. They certainly do not have all of the information they need to respond to the problem, and that our best response is one that's comprehensive. Hi, how are you? Secondly, what we've seen happen is recognition that as we take on the issues of terrorism more broadly, even globally, that we have to incorporate this concept into the work we're doing. That's why I'm particularly proud of what we did with United Nations Security Council Resolution 2178. That Security Council resolution was really focused on fighting, on dealing with the issue of foreign fighters. But what we did was we explicitly recognize that it's not just about exchanging intelligence. It's not just about exchanging information between governments about our borders. It really needs to be about sharing best practices, identifying ways to counter the root causes of extremism in the first place. And so this was something the United States put forward. It's something that we've advocated continually, but it's a recognition that this needs to be a global solution to a major problem.
Welcome, Undersecretary Sewell. Thank you for joining us. That's okay. We're talking about CVE. No surprise.
Good. I'm in the right place.
You're in the right on the right panel, and you've really been very instrumental in advancing this agenda around CVE in your tenure here at Department of State. I think what we'd like to ask you is, since the White House summit in 2015, what do you see as the biggest gains that we've made, and where do you see we need room for improvement in advancing this particular approach to the problem of violent extremism?
Well, thanks for the question. I think I'll talk about a couple of different elements in which I think we've made enormous progress, but I want to really emphasize how tentative this is given the scope of the problem and the generational nature of the threat. And so I'm very proud of the steps that this administration has made, and I think there's a lot more that can be done to institutionalize this going forward. Most specifically, since the White House summit, I think we've seen a real focusing on both the policy and the programmatic aspects of international support for CVE partners. And those partners are different than the partners we've typically worked with on the CT side. So in addition to working with states whose actions have to be carefully monitored and encouraged so that they don't exacerbate the problem of violent extremism, we work with civil society and we work to do capacity building at the community level. My favorite example so far of what we've been able to do, and I hope that it's a real pilot and an inspiration for moving forward, is the work that we did at State with AID to approach the problem in a different way than we had before. We took the Al-Shabaab as a problem set. We looked at where it had been moving and threatening in terms of its impact and its recruiting. We identified the places and the communities most vulnerable to that recruitment and radicalization. And then working with Post, working with civil society organizations, and working in a really integrated way across the US government, we prioritized a couple of key areas in which we did holistic investments that combined the policy interaction with the government actors and the support for communities themselves to build resilience against radical messages. If you think about CVE as essentially taking the broad tools of our foreign policy and using them not just for humanitarian purposes, but also to secure a security dividend, then you can see that we have enormous scope to expand this approach globally. And that's, I think, really hopeful and exciting, and it's a positive message, it's an affirmative message, it's an empowering message, at a time when I think that's what we really need to galvanize the international community. And you know, the UN has now embraced preventing violent extremism, which is its lexicon for countering violent extremism, but it's embraced that at the level of the UN counterterrorism strategy. And so that brings a whole lot of new actors to the game, and it brings a whole lot of capabilities to the game that we didn't used to think of as being highly germane. For example, UNESCO has developed a terrific curriculum on tolerance and on critical thinking. And you know, we don't typically think of UNESCO as being a partner in the counter-terror fight, but it's very much a partner in preventing violent extremism. And so I think we have laid very important groundwork for a different approach, both analytically, programmatically, and pairing programming and policy interventions in the national sense. And then I think we've built a much more coherent and integrated international approach to countering violent extremism. I want to just make one more point, if I could, and I know that we don't have a lot of time, but the final points that I wanted to make are the moving forward, we need to think about how we can tell the story across communities, both the security community and the rights community, because CVE is one of these areas that really requires both to be working together, and I think there's a big opportunity for the next administrations to both build on the monitoring and evaluation to show the impact of these programs, but also to embed within a unified strand of American foreign policy the sense that doing good is making us more secure, and that we can pursue the kinds of values that we stand for as a country while making ourselves and our partners safer in the long haul. And so I think that's a huge opportunity before us. I also think it will be interesting to see how the incoming administration, given that it is being given direction from Congress to really collapse the National Security Council structures,
and decrease the number of staff to see what opportunities that might create for greater integration of what have traditionally been seen as our counterterrorism efforts and our foreign policy efforts. And those could in turn reinforce a lot of the really interesting work that Amy and others have been pioneering, which is getting our local law enforcement and our local CVE lessons learned into international practice, but also bringing those bigger foreign policy muscle movements, whether it's the UN, whether it's the World Bank, international financial institutions, the private sector, et cetera, to be part of an effort to reinforce community resilience so that the problem doesn't spread while we continue to pursue the hard security measures that we need against the current terror threat.
Okay, thank you. Essentially, we are here to talk about two reports that have recently come out as well. And one of them is the CSIS Commission report on countering violent extremism. And one thing I really appreciated about this particular report was how it really underscored the importance of a measured security response. And Shannon, I know this is something that's been an important issue for you in terms of the promotion of human rights as a component of a CVE strategy. So how do we operationalize that idea? How do you ensure that security responses are not exacerbating the grievances that actually fuel violent extremism? And what are your recommendations to put forth a more just and sustainable role for security actors while also maintaining a progress in the CVE agenda?
Thanks, Georgia. So taking a step back, the CVE Commission was comprised of 23 people from a variety of backgrounds and sectors and walks of life. So I think the recommendations in the report truly represent a bipartisan consensus on what the next administration needs to do to advance CVE in a way that builds on all of the progress and the work that's been done really over the last 15 years, and particularly over the last couple of years, thanks to the folks to my right. So we tried to look at the problem of violent extremism as a system with multiple layers and drivers and actors involved. And if you look at it as a system, you see all the different ways that these factors interact. And it becomes very clear, as Sarah said, that you can't just do CVE programs. You have to look at the policies and the practices that help create sort of this nefarious cycle of violence, both in the United States and internationally. So for example, in the domestic context, we interviewed countless people who pointed out that there really is this sort of negative cycle between anti-Muslim, anti-immigrant sentiment, and violent extremism, in the sense that terrorist recruiters are able to play upon those sentiments and tell their targets that you're not wanted in this society, you'll never belong. So basically what we're saying is in the domestic space, the US government needs to avoid policies and actions and rhetoric that plays into that cycle. And that would really mean operationally redoubling efforts to address the real legitimate concerns of Muslim communities within the US, whether that be about surveillance and stigmatization or the hate crimes that are becoming so rampant, and really continues the engagement that we've seen under the current administration. And we argue that this isn't a matter of political correctness, this is just smart, effective strategy. Abroad, we tried to look at the way that our traditional partners are potentially feeding into the spread of extremist ideologies. So for example, we traced the evolution of extremism back really 50, 60 years and concluded that for a generation or more, some private donors in the Gulf have been contributing to the spread of extremist ideologies by funding mosques and schools and various types of media that reject local religious, cultural, social, and political customs that contradict their own understandings and values. So what we say is rather than ignoring this reality, we really need to call on these partner countries to take additional concrete steps to deter, disrupt, dismantle funding to groups and individuals that are a part of this process of exporting extremist ideologies. And essentially, the Commission report says, primarily, it's on those countries to take those steps, but the international community has an obligation, if they aren't going to take steps to stem the spread of extremist ideologies, and should consider punitive measures, such as freezing of assets, visa and travel bans, and criminal actions for those who support or provide material support to extremist activity. In that regard, we also call for a global educational partnership, building on what Sarah mentioned, which is UNESCO's really good work in trying to inculcate tolerance in school systems. And essentially what this global educational partnership would do is commit countries to ensure that extremist ideologies and hatred and intolerance are not being embedded in the education system and educational materials. So essentially, they would be committing to expunge that kind of hatred and intolerance from the education systems. We essentially say for this to be effective, robust monitoring and evaluation measures need to be put in place. And the US government, along with other international actors, should consider different measures that could be taken if countries didn't live up to these commitments. And then finally, Georgia, as you mentioned, we looked at some really interesting emerging data that suggests that violent extremism often thrives in environments characterized by oppressive, abusive, or predatory governments. And, you know, we found that where governments do exhibit these behaviors, people are often motivated by a desire for justice and dignity. So we thought that it was important in a CVE strategy that the next administration would adopt to, again, make sure that our own partnerships, particularly our security and counterterrorism partnerships, weren't fueling these grievances that feed into these cycles of violence. So what we call for, again, is that the next administration conduct a thorough review of all weapons transfers, train and equip programs, and other security assistance provided to countries that Freedom House considers not free or partially free, and really considers very thoughtfully whether or not that assistance is doing more to counter extremism and terrorism, or is actually feeding into those cycles of extremism and violence. So finally, in terms of operationalizing those ideas, we thought that it was really important to have somebody that could look across the domestic and international space, across CT and CVE, to make sure that our policies were consistent and were advancing the goal of countering violent extremism. So in the commission report, we call for the appointment of an assistant to the president that would be situated between the National Security Advisor responsible for Homeland Security and the National Security Advisor who's primarily responsible for foreign policy and regional issues. And that person would be the person who's ultimately accountable for making sure that there are results on the CVE front, and would be accountable for the president for making sure that progress was made on CVE.
Thanks, Shannon. Eric, your report really gets into the weeds of CVE practice and policy, and you also have some very specific recommendations on organizational and resource changes and challenges that might help advance this agenda. Can you outline some of those for us?
Sure, and thanks to USIP for hosting another dynamic conversation on CVE, and let's hope that these kinds of conversations can carry forward into the next administration. I think the first comment I would make is that the part of the challenge we're facing here is that when governments talk about CVE, they talk about counterterrorism often, and when communities think of CVE, they think of everything but counterterrorism. And they don't want to be told by external actors that the reason why communities need to become more resilient, the reason why communities need to build more better relationships with law enforcement, the reason why communities need to create alternatives to young people who are at the risk of being recruited into violence is because of an external agenda. There are many more pressing concerns often in those communities that's worrying the parents, that's worrying the families, that's worrying the professionals than terrorism, even though terrorism may be an issue. So the challenge in sort of operationalizing and sustaining all this this positive momentum is to find a way to meld these two often different approaches to the problem set, or different perspectives on the problem set. And I think collectively, the sort of the CVE community has been very good at laying out this broad framework in terms of needing to go beyond security actors. been very good about pushing this notion that we have to go down to the community level. Communities are on the front lines of the effort. They're the closest to the problem set and best able to identify early signs of radicalization and intervene against it. But what's going to motivate these communities? What's going to incentivize these communities to do this? And I think this gets into some of the organizational issues that my report tries to highlight, whether it's at the international level, where you have an international architecture that's driven by member states of the UN or regional organizations, that's often driven by diplomats who aren't necessarily reflecting the concerns of communities in their country when they're talking about CVE or counterterrorism. It's a very state-centric system. So how are the voices from these communities going to be heard in international conversations around counterterrorism and CVE so that some of the rhetoric around CVE at that global level can be challenged because for the failure to sort of translate into action. In the national level, how can we get more and more governments to develop national action plans on countering violent extremism that are, again, reflective of community concerns, that are reflective of subnational actors' involvement, and that actually empower local communities not to necessarily implement counterterrorism or countering violent extremism strategies, but to develop locally owned, locally generated strategies that are going to prevent a variety of forms of violence in the community, including violent extremism. And I don't think we're there yet. I think we're still sort of trying to figure out, is CVE a counterterrorism issue? Is CVE more of a development issue? Is it a community resilience issue? And it's just a very challenging to sort of meld these two separate communities. And I think at the community level in particular, we have to figure out a way that non-law enforcement actors in these communities, whether it's social workers, whether it's teachers, whether it's public health officials at the community level, whether it's parents and peers and religious leaders, they can sort of join together, not because of a security imperative, but because of that's again imposed externally, but because of a locally generated set of concerns with external funding to support programs in that area that aren't sort of imposed from outside. And I think that's, for me, is the fundamental challenge, is that we all talk about communities, even in this country. Communities are seen as the sort of the core of the solutions here. But how do you actually generate locally owned solutions that can be implemented in a sustainable way that don't require national government funding, that don't require national level direction or monitoring, that it's actually the community themselves organizing around the problem set? And I think we're unfortunately not there yet, and I'm just very concerned that the approach that the next administration is signaling in the transition phase is anathema to that sort of ethos. And I think it's more important than ever that those of us who have invested some time and energy in developing sort of and pushing out the CV agenda, that we can't expect that national governments will continue to be a benign champion of this agenda, and that it's really incumbent upon those outside of government, those in civil society, those at the community level, those in international organizations to champion this agenda, not necessarily from a security perspective, but from a perspective of protecting communities, local communities, and adding this extra layer of defense in these communities to a variety of forms of violence. But it's a pretty steep hill we have to climb right now.
So Eric, two very challenging issues you bring up here. One is, how do you actually implement something that needs to be locally generated and locally grown and owned? How do you ensure sort of the organic nature of community level CVE programming? And the other one you alluded to is this really true challenge we have in coordination just within the US government on advancing this agenda. One thing I really appreciated about the CSIS report, Shannon, is how frankly you unpacked some of these issues, conceptual issues around CVE that have been sort of the source of conflict and a barrier to coordination. And I think it's always important to sort of have a frank conversation about why there are these differences and why there isn't full agreement on what CVE is and what is the best way forward. Do you think you can outline for us some of these issues?
Sure. So as Georgia mentioned, and as many of you are likely aware, there has been a lot of controversy around CVE. I think it's important to go back to what the original purpose is and was, which is to move away from a purely securitized approach to violent extremism. Sort of recognize, as Amy mentioned, that we're not going to be able to address this challenge by solely resorting to intelligence collection or bombs or locking people up. So people were recognizing, look, we have to move further upstream and prevent people from being radicalized. I think a number of things have created the controversy, including by and large the fact that law enforcement agencies, because of their reach into local communities, have been oftentimes on the forefront or the leading edge of engaging with communities. So it automatically puts it into that realm of a counterterrorism issue. And as Eric mentioned, there's been a lot of resentment among some communities about that approach. So questions like, why are you coming to my community solely concerned about terrorism? We have all of these other problems. We've got hate crimes, we've got poverty, we've got poor education. Terrorism ranks, 10th maybe on a list of priorities. And so a sense of resentment that when these communities are engaged is oftentimes as a security issue. So that's one of the problems. There have been concerns amongst human rights groups and civil liberties groups about the implications of CVE. So concerns about, when does the speech that one might use that expresses support for an extremist organization, or when does even becoming radicalized and embracing certain ideas and values become a crime? And concern about communities being surveyed and that their speech might be constrained because of this desire to stamp out violent extremism. I think amongst people who are operating in the international space, there's also been a concern that over time, CVE, which is always poorly defined, has just sort of grown and grown and grown, and a question about where are the parameters. So there are some people who say, if you can't define it, then how do we know what the ultimate objective is, and then how do we measure whether or not it's working? So there's been a concern, I think, a bit about mission creep. And while some people are embracing this even further move upstream under the rubric of preventing violent extremism, there are others that are pushing back against that because they say, well, when is it CVE versus development? And so there are some people who want to sort of bring those boundaries back in again and have a tighter definition of CVE. For me, I think one thing that's been effective is some of the work that people who are looking at CVE from a public health perspective have done. And there's this idea of a pyramid, or this idea of primary, secondary, and tertiary interventions. For me, it's helpful to think about the kinds of stuff that Eric was talking about as the bottom layer of the pyramid. So the stuff that's really embedded in communities, where you're talking about community resilience, you're talking about addressing some of those underlying drivers and causes, that to me is something that should primarily be led by communities, and there's little to no role for law enforcement, in my opinion, at that basic level of the pyramid. In the pyramid, the secondary level are those who might be indicating an interest in extremist ideologies but have not yet been radicalized. Again, I think primarily communities and civic groups should lead those interventions, and they should do so on the basis of their expertise. So this is not something that I think people should just dabble in. I think you do need to be trained. And again, very little role for law enforcement agencies at that layer of the pyramid. But then as you reach the top layer of the pyramid, and people have been radicalized, even if they haven't committed a criminal act yet, and community groups, again, might be in the lead in terms of trying to de-radicalize those individuals, clearly because there is a threat present, I think that's where law enforcement agencies do have a stronger role. So for me, part of it is just being more deliberate about what space we're operating in and who are the primary actors in each of those spaces, and where possible, trying to desecuritize the work and getting law enforcement out unless it's in the tippy top of the pyramid where there is an actual threat.
So I'm going to ask both of our seated officials, since they've been meeting this challenge of coordination in this very complex space, what would be their best advice to the incoming administration on continuing to advance this agenda, and how would you go about doing that? Could we start, Undersecretary?
Sure, thanks, Georgia. I think there are two different questions that are really paramount in the next iteration of this endeavor. And one is coordination. I mean, without prejudice to the specifics, I think there is a real need to bring together the voices and the analysis of those who think about the immediate threat from an intelligence and military perspective with the voices that think about how do you stabilize areas in general, how do you give communities hope about the future in general, and how do you think about how our policy and programmatic interventions can help prevent bad things from happening and reinforce good things where they are happening. Right now, those happen in two separate silos. There is not an integration of views. And I think that's absolutely critical going forward, in part because we risk not thinking about the second order consequences of the first pillar of our activities, whether it's our counterterrorism partnerships, whether it's the way we use military force against active terror threats, whether it's the capacities that we build overseas. And that is not to say we don't need all of those things. That is to say we have to be cognizant of where where we might better readjust all those activities to not accrue the negative second-order effects, or work with our partners to help them better understand their own self-interest in doing things differently. So I think that's one huge piece of the puzzle. I think the second piece of the puzzle is resources. There's just no getting around the fact that if you look at, again, and you know, my world, I see two cones. I see our CT cone and our CVE cone, and I don't see them integrated. When I look for CVE budgets, you know, it's, where are they, right? You know, the reality is, for very good reasons, we built up a massive infrastructure post 9/11. And we put, you know, hundreds of billions of dollars into a huge set of capabilities that are really important for our security. And we have not dropped a perceptible, you know, impact into the balancing of those hard side efforts with the softer side efforts that I think ultimately are what we need for success on the hard side. And so, you know, when you think about whatever analogy you want to use, a preventive, a disease control analogy, whether you want to think about this as building buildings and you need to have a recapitalization of your building, you need to have a relationship between your preventive efforts and your response efforts. And right now, those resources are so fundamentally mismatched. And where they do exist, and trust me, this has been my life for the last 3 years, they are in pockets that are individually controlled, and there is no synergy among them, no prioritization of them, and they're not integrated appropriately. And so I think we have a huge amount to do both on the rebalancing of our resources and the rebalancing of our policymaking and the integration of the same.
Can I just say something very quickly on resources? So we did some analysis to try to get our heads around how much we're actually spending on CVE versus CT. And it's difficult because, again, both of those things are ill-defined and some things are classified. But essentially, based on the best data we could find, we found that we're spending less than 0.1% on CVE as opposed to CT. So there's actually a chart in the report that shows that itsy-bitsy little dot that CVE versus CT. So again, the commission did call for that rebalancing that Sarah was talking about, including by starting with $1 billion annual investment from the US government in CVE.
So advice for the next administration. One, I would say it's not actually, I'm gonna disagree a little bit with Sarah, because I work on the National Security Council and my day-to-day job is bringing together the different departments and agencies to confront an issue. So we do have
departments and agencies from the intelligence community representing the Defense Department. We have officials representing Homeland Security, State Department, Justice Department, et cetera, all sitting around the table trying to figure out what is our right approach here. So it's not that the issue of CT and CVE have not been coordinated. They are not. It's not that there's no integration. It's just that this balancing that both Sarah and Shannon have remarked upon has not been achieved. So my advice to the next administration is that we need to go big on our CVE efforts. We're amassing more and more evidence that the work we're doing within communities is paying off, that it's absolutely critical that we make these kinds of investments, that we address the grievances that are causing people to radicalize to violence, that we take head on the ideology that encourages people to act in violent ways rather than engaging within their communities, that we invest in things like human dignity, in democracy, in building up civil society, that is the way that we're ultimately gonna be successful. And we need to make sure, the next administration needs to make sure that conversation is happening at the same time as what we're doing on counterterrorism, that they need to be much, much better integrated. So we see that starting now. That has been an important tenet of President Obama's policy on CVE. But for this to be successful, it really needs to grow significantly. We have sort of the initial efforts have started. We have initial evidence coming in. But unless we really make this a key investment, I don't think that we'll see the kind of success that we all anticipate we would see. The second thing, and this is in terms of advice to the next administration, is that we have a lot of evidence about what doesn't work. Since 9/11, we have watched experiment after experiment basically be tried and fail. And I would look particularly to the question of creating this us versus them mentality. When we put law enforcement and our intelligence community in a situation where they were looking at particular communities as a whole and communities indiscriminately, regardless of individual actors, we actually created more conflict between government and between communities. And that conflict actually fuels violent extremism, and it fuels distrust, which makes it far less likely that government officials will know what's happening and will be able to respond appropriately. So I think, you know, especially we're coming off a campaign where there's been a lot of rhetoric about who's who and who believes what, and I'd urge the next administration, let's take a step back from the us versus them. Let's look at these, especially here at home, although it's true around the world, let's look at these as American communities. Let's continue to build the relationships, to break down the barriers between law enforcement, between community actors. Let's find the evidence about what really works, and let's fund what really works. And let's look to, you know, Eric mentioned looking at communities, but communities, we believe, do have the answers. We believe they are the ones who best know what factors are fueling grievances, what factors are fueling alienation, who within a community is becoming more and more disaffected, what is the best way to deal with that disaffection. And so the onus on the next administration is to take this to the next level, to figure out how we better grow these nascent efforts rather than creating a barrier between government and the U.S., the rest of the U.S.
Amen. Thank you. And what I'd like to do now is open this up to the audience so that we have an opportunity to have a broader discussion about these issues. I know there are a lot of people in the room who've been working on these issues for some time, and this is an opportunity for us to share some of our own ideas and experiences of what will continue to help advance this agenda and where its strengths and weaknesses might be. So are there any questions from the audience?
Dave Ottaway from the Wilson Center. I found this discussion very interesting, but very abstract. And I wonder if you could give us some concrete examples, particularly working with some country or some government abroad, where you've tried to apply this approach and what reaction you've gotten. Because at least in the Arab world, civil society is now a very dirty word. governments are very suspicious of them. They don't want to work with civil society because they feel that's the group that started the Arab uprising in the first place. So can you give us some examples of working with countries or governments where this approach you're talking about has been tried?
Do you want to take a few, or
why don't we start with that one, because that's an important one. So
I might start with a micro example and then ask Sarah to provide the more macro examples. But I just want to sort of give a shout out to a particular community that I met with when I was in The Hague. And in The Hague, as you probably know, within the Netherlands, the number of foreign fighters who are folks who have left to go fight is disproportionately high. And so there has been a very concerted effort by the mayor and the law enforcement community in that particular city to engage with their community there. And what I saw was a group of moms actually begin to identify for each other how do we observe what's happening within our communities and with our children? How do we build the links with our law enforcement? They actually had a round table where they had police officers, mental health professionals, teachers, and other school officials, and just a range of sort of government actors and social service providers sitting with the moms around the table. And the number of moms they'd been able to train within this community was quite significant. But more importantly is that they were able to identify and intervene very quickly when they saw some of the children begin to exhibit behaviors that were of concern. So this was, you know, this is just one tiny little micro example, but kind of what the kind of example that we want to see around the world, where we have real breakdown between we're breaking down the barriers between the community actors and the people who live within the community. Or Eric.
So David, if I understood your question correctly, you were really asking about the relationship between policy that's predicated on the empowerment of civil society and a reality on the ground in many areas that are at risk of violent extremism spreading, in which the space for civil society is diminished. And so the first thing I want to say is you're right, that is a real problem that we are working with. And I think one of the most important things for those who believe that civil society is a critical ingredient for a future world we want to see more generally is that CVE is perhaps one of the most compelling ways in which we can help elevate the role and the importance of civil society to governments that feel that it may not be in their short-term best self-interest to provide that space. In other words, if the point that we can make is that in the long run, these communities are essential partners in securing the country from violent extremism, that's a potential game changer in terms of how those relationships work. That's easier in theory than in practice, and we could talk about specific cases and how hard that is, but I think in general, one cannot underestimate the importance of the whole CVE prevention enterprise for preserving the role, the essential role of civil society in whether it is, you know, public goods or security. I think to the more specific manifestation of your question, which is how can we see that it works, one of the interesting things that I observed as we were canvassing CVE efforts, which have been going on for a long time, but in a very sort of piecemeal, pointillistic way, that weren't integrated and weren't prioritized, is that it's very difficult to see the impact that you want to see when that's the extent of your programming, uncoordinated, somewhat random, and isolated interventions. And that's why what we've tried to do with the East Africa pilot is a completely different approach that I described earlier. That's new. We're just starting to actually let the grants for that now. That's the problem with the time that it sometimes takes the federal government to work. But I think the best example I can provide you in the short term is some of the work that we've done in Pakistan, that AID had done in Pakistan years prior, where they were able to focus on specific communities, engage over a period of years in an integrated way, and they were able to measure things like attitudes towards the government, attitudes towards violent extremists, movement of youth outside of those communities. Those are some of the very basic M&E indicators that can be very useful in making the case that interventions that we might think of as, you know, frothy foreign assistance programs can actually have a tangible impact on security at the local level, and then because of the globalization of this threat and the movement of people and ideas,
ultimately impact on the global level.
Yeah, I think it's a very, very pertinent question. I think one of the sort of stories so far in terms of the CVE effort that the U.S. and other Western governments have really pushed is that it hasn't really penetrated to the most critical part of the world in terms of today's immediate threats. And the reality is that CVE conversations with those governments in the Middle East and North Africa tend to focus on counter-messaging. They're easy conversations to have with authoritarian governments because it's not about their behavior. They can help push out messages about certain interpretations of Islam. They can use that as a vehicle to prop up certain government-favored religious leaders. And that's basically become CVE in the Arab world. And I think all the stuff that about civil society, all the stuff about how governments treat their citizens is too often seen through a human rights lens and not through a security lens in our discussions. And I think, I mean, I'll say this with a straight face, but it's hard to say it with a straight face, that my hope is that the next administration learns this lesson from the previous administration and actually integrates all these foreign policy tools so that we're actually engaging governments in that region on civil society, on how they treat their citizens in the context of a security discussion. But I'm not holding my breath. And I think the other just thing to point out is all this focus on civil society and communities. If you actually look, and for my project, we've gathered a bunch of data. We're still in the process of data collection, but 850 civil society organizations around the world implementing about 1,000 projects. Again, it's not exhaustive at all, in sort of this CVE or CVE relevant space. 100 countries are touched here, and the vast majority of these are in the prevention area. They're not in the intervention, so they're not in the space where individuals have sort of are about to cross the threshold. And they're certainly not in the rehabilitation and reintegration space, which is the most pressing set of issues now in terms of all the returning foreign fighters and in terms of all the defections from Boko Haram or al-Shabaab. So any progress we've made so far has been in the really easy, safe areas where few would really object to communities having a role to play because it's sort of building on existing violence prevention programs they may already have in their community. The challenge is, how do we create legal and policy frameworks to allow civil society and communities to enter the space closer to the immediate threat? And related challenges, the program that Amy described in The Hague is a wonderful one, but it's not really replicable to a non-Western context because you don't have, in non-Western context, you don't have a national government that is empowering local authorities to do that. In non-Western context, you generally don't have local communities that have enough trust in their local police that they can sit down at the table and engage in all these issues in a sort of safe space. So these are huge issues to deal with if you want to see the CVE agenda be more than sort of a Western, very important, but still very much Western kind of agenda.
Hi, Juliet Schmidt with IFAS. I just had a question. Somebody mentioned that it being difficult to distill sort of the core difference between development and CVE work. And I just wondered, in your opinions, what do you think that difference is?
There was one more question here in the front.
Thank you for your presentation. I'm Mike Kraft, a counterterrorism writer. And a couple of years ago, in working on a book on U.S. government counterterrorism programs, I found that there was not too much coordination at times between the Homeland Security people and FBI in reaching out to local communities. I wonder if this coordination has improved. And another sort of nitty-gritty question, having worked in Congress and dealt with Congress, some of the committees and members look towards how do you measure success. Now, if a person decides not to become a lone wolf because of some reach out, he doesn't exactly call up the FBI or somebody and said, hey, I'm about to commit something and I pulled back because of because of your efforts. So how do you deal with this issue of trying to, you know, measure success and quantify it in order to get more resources from Congress?
Let's take a third question, and then we can have each panelist respond.
Michelle Brignon, thank you. I just had a question. You had talked about punitive measures for foreign countries or just individual actors who fund, encourage, whatever, violent extremism, like funding mosques and whatnot in the U.S. And my question is, would you or could you carry those same punitive measures over to U.S. actors who encourage and frequently fund? We don't call it violent extremism, but there's, like, you know, there's a lot of hate crimes and whatnot that are frequently encouraged. I mean, this election cycle has just been horrible for that. And so, you know, freedom of speech issues, you know, present themselves, but would you carry those punitive measures over to U.S. actors as well, or would you only apply them to international actors?
Okay, some good questions here. Who would like to take a first stab?
I will. I'll start with the development one, since that's the community I came from. So I think in a lot of the environments in which violent extremism thrives are also development challenges. So you're talking about fragile environments, oftentimes, that have a legacy of poverty and inequality and marginalization and justice deficits, all problems that in and of themselves are worthy of trying to tackle. But also can be drivers of violent extremism. So again, at that bottom layer of the pyramid where you're trying to address some of those underlying grievances and causes, I think the difference between a purely development program and a CVE program is one of intent and design. So I think you have to be very clear about what you're trying to address through that program. So for example, we did an event with Mercy Corps, I think it was just last week, and they were featuring a report that they just produced on a USAID-funded program in Somalia. And essentially the program was improving access to secondary education, and in some locations it was just the secondary education, and in other locations it was coupled with civic engagement opportunities. And they did a very rigorous study, and what they found was in cases where they had combined the education access with the civic engagement opportunities, they saw a drop in both support and participation in violent extremism, whereas in the locations where they just did the access to secondary education, they saw a drop in participation, but not in support. So that what that says to me, essentially, is that if you want to do a CVE program using developmental approaches or developmental tools, you can't just do it willy-nilly. You have to do it very thoughtfully based on an assessment of what are the particular drivers in that location, and then design a program with the intent of reducing support and engagement and violence. And then you need to monitor it very carefully, because a lot of our assumptions about what is causing people to join extremist movements are incorrect. And sometimes you have consequences that are unintended. So you need to apply these kind of rigorous M&E techniques that Mercy Corps did to make sure that you're having the intended impact. On the punitive measures, I mean, again, there are laws around this. So it's not just if somebody expresses support for an extremist ideology. It's when they're providing material support to a terrorist organization or to an individual who is espousing violence. So there has to be that connection to a threat. Amy could probably talk more about what we do in the domestic arena, but certainly anything that would apply to other countries, we would apply the same standards to ourselves. But again, it's just it's important to be very careful that it is connected to a threat of violence versus just cracking down on all organizations that might espouse views that you find very deplorable, but are protected as free speech.
Yeah, I can say a couple, respond to a couple of the comments. I'm a prosecutor by background, and I can tell you that the tools that we have here in the United States are actually probably far more effective and targeted than what we can use overseas. So we can individually, if we believe that an individual is inciting people to violence or providing support to a terrorist group, there are very specific laws that allow us to identify that individual. Whereas a lot of times when we're looking at sanctions, it tends to be a much broader brush. The second piece of it is that we can be far more effective in carrying out the criminal prosecution here in the United States than we could abroad. I think this sort of points to a bigger issue, which is something that Eric alluded to earlier, that the approach to CVE is not a one-size-fits-all. There's not, what we see work in The Hague is not gonna work in Jordan. What we see work in, somewhere in Minnesota is not necessarily what's gonna work in France. I mean, it's just, these are different communities, and I think the key lesson that we've taken away from the past 8 years of work on this is that you cannot apply a broad brush and expect to get stellar results. You really have to know the communities that you're working with. You really need to understand the particular cultural back and forth and understand the particular governments. And so it's why we've stressed again the need to engage at a very grassroots level. With respect to the question about the Department of Homeland Security and FBI not coordinating well, that is something we too recognized several years into our tenure here. That drove first the creation of our strategy, but then more recently we stood up the Interagency Task Force to Counter Violent Extremism, which is here in Washington. And it's co-led by the Department of Homeland Security and the Department of Justice. But most importantly, it has representatives from our core domestic agencies that work on CVE. So FBI is an important part of that task force. And these folks are all working in the same building. They're putting together common materials. They are coordinating on who's speaking where and what they're saying. They're just trying to ensure that we as the federal government have our house in order, because we recognize there were, some folks would say one thing and some folks would say another, and it was confusing at best and not helpful in many cases. So we've learned that lesson, and we're trying to do better from a bureaucratic point of view. But at the same time, this is one of the places where we think the next administration would do well to grow that task force, to invest in that task force, and really to give it some license to improve the coordination and improve the efficacy of our work here at home.
I will just addressing a couple of those questions just on the DHS DOJ coordination. I think I would fully agree with what Amy said in terms of the improvements. I think one of the key areas where much more improvement is needed is to bring in non-law enforcement federal actors as co-leads to the task force. So it's not a law enforcement, not a perceived to be an overly securitized task force, even though we all know both DHS and DOJ do much more than simply enforce the law and provide security. But the perception in communities is that it still is overly securitized. And to actually bring in state and local representation, to bring in community representation into the task force, maybe not as full members, but to give them sort of a voice, some voice in at the federal level. And I think that's a good practice that should be pushed out to other countries as they're looking to develop sort of CVE coordination mechanisms. And I think on the development, where does development end and where does CVE start? I think one of the, and again, I agree with how Shannon outlined it. I think one of the challenges that almost every country has a different, and every CVE practitioner or policymaker has a slightly different take on where that the line is between the two. And in an environment where their resources are limited, you don't see additional resources being fueled into CVE, despite the fact that it's such a high policy issue. Development actors are increasingly, I wouldn't say
simply relabeling traditional development programs as CVE, but in some cases that's what they're doing. And the result is that you get what's already a kind of mushy area in between the two is becoming even mushier. The UN was doing a cataloging of which of its agencies have developed CVE or PVE in their parlance, or PVE relevant programs. And I kid you not that about a third of the programs that I saw were simply they changed either a development concept to PVE, so it was a program that had been education, now had a PVE acronym slapped on it, or a program that had been counterterrorism had a PVE acronym slapped onto it. So it was not doing what Shannon was advocating for, which is actually retailoring existing programs to actually give them a PVE or CVE objective. It's simply relabeling. And I think that's a real risk we're facing, particularly in the UN context, where there is still, they want to be part of the game, but they don't really want to compromise their existing programs. But they think by slightly relabeling it, they can get more money. So it's a real challenge, I think, for the next phase of CVE work, is how to really, without trying to define it, because I think searching for a definition among 193 countries will be a fool's errand, but I think how can you sort of delineate the playing fields so that people know when they're on a PVE playing field and when they're not, and I think we're not there yet.
I do think that it's important to note that we do have a model of how it can be done. The East Africa pilot is a really good example of how there was careful analysis, there was pooled funding, there was collective decision making that involved consultations that were local, and you can do it. What it requires is a better sense of what resources are available, and then a forced collective prioritization of where they need to go, and then a tailored application to the specifics of the problem set, because as everybody has said, they differ by place. But I do think we have a template for how to do it. The question is, do we have the political will to set up our systems so that we can execute that template?
So I think it's true that a lot of policy and strategy conversations, especially on CVE, can be quite abstract, but it's rare that they're this frank. So I'd like to thank our speakers, really, for speaking from a very authentic place about these challenges. So thank you very much for taking the time this morning. Thank you to all of you who came out this morning. Please join me in a round of applause.
Thank you very much.